And before I even move past this moment, I just would like to open up in a word of prayer. If everyone would just bow their head, close your eyes. And Father God, we thank you right now. Lord, we thank you for being God all by yourself. Lord, we thank you for who you are. And we thank you for whose we are. Lord, we thank you for every man that has pressed their way, even to be out here this early in the morning, decided they're going to lay aside everything else that they got going on to be able to come together with a bunch of other men of God, to be able to give you honor, to be able to talk about things that allow for us to know who we are, created in your image. And I ask you to bless this session even on this morning. Bless us, God. We thank you. We thank you for your presence. We thank you. We thank you that you would speak to us individually, for you know what we need more than we even know to ask. Speak to us, God. And I thank you just for being a vessel to be used by you. Continue to hide me behind your cross, even throughout this next 45 minutes. Lord, you have your way. And we ask for your divine insight, even on this morning, this early morning. We thank you that we don't need the coffee, although we need the coffee, to wake us up. But we got Jesus that woke us up this morning. For this is the day that he's made, and we'll rejoice and be glad in it. The church is saying, amen. Amen. Come on, one more time. Just give God praise. Clap your hands, open your mouth, and give God praise one more time. Come on, give him praise for who he is. I thank God for the opportunity to be here again. I've already been introduced. My name is Alvin Dupree, a senior pastor at Family First Ministries, a Church of God in Christ. Bottom line, even with being a senior pastor, I'm just a man who loves the Lord. A little bit of background about me is, I'm a 20-year retired combat veteran of the United States Marine Corps. I have a father who's still living. He raised me to be a man of God. He taught me that no matter what you do, no matter where you go, everything that you do, you need to do it unto the glory of God. And I had those teachings from a very young childhood. And any thought that I have of my father, I remember him teaching me to be a man of God. However, when I was 21 and growing up throughout those teenage years, I decided that although my dad's there and I have no sad story to tell, I'm not trying to be that person my daddy wants me to be. I want to be who I want to be. I need to get away from this church. My daddy's pastor, and it seems like everywhere I go, everything that I do, daddy's watching me. Because somebody knows daddy. They know who I am. Boy, you that PK. You ain't finna be around us. Get out of this house party. I'm like, come on, man. This ain't right. Daddy's, he's reaching out, and he got a lot of the gang members from the community in Kansas City, Kansas, in the downtown slum area. A lot of those gangsters was coming to the church, and daddy was preaching to them and reaching them and touching those young men, touching their hearts, being a father to the ones who didn't have a father. So a lot of rebellion and not understanding why is daddy spending time with those boys and he's not spending time with me. So the enemy was able to get inside, although I had a father there, the enemy was able to kind of get me upset because I felt like I was being neglected and I have a father right here in my house. So what I decided, even throughout my teenage years, that, you know, instead of being like my father, I want to be with the drug dealers and the gangsters that come into the church. So we'll sneak out after church and we'll go hang out. And throughout that course of time, once I hit 21, I decided, okay, I'm done with this. I need to go find some place to go to where I can actually get away from my daddy's shadow. And there was no better place that I could find other than joining the United States Marine Corps. I was able to leave, and one of the things that attracted me to the Marines out of all the other military branches, first is the fact that my daddy was in the Army, did 3 tours in Vietnam. So I wanted to spite my father and say, okay, you want the Army? Let me choose the other branch just to spite you. So I chose the Marines. Ain't that pretty good right there? I chose the Marines. And the Marine Corps sent me to the most partying state that I feel there is. And that state was in San Diego, California. Down there, it was like, wow. So all this stuff that I was seeing on TV, it really exists. All these women that are dropping it and flipping and doing all that stuff, that was a perfect place for a person who was running away from the Lord. Joined in that Marine Corps, found myself getting wrapped up in all types of stuff. And here I was, just falling very rapidly down Sparrow to a life of sin. Met my girlfriend, met her at a club. We start shacking together. Living, shacking is living together. That's the terminology we use. I heard my daddy preaching, boy, you can't live, save, and shack at the same time. So here I am shacking. And even after living with this girl for almost a year, I could hear my daddy's sermons beat me up inside my head. You know, it's better to marry than to burn in lust. You better get married, God sees you. So out of that kind of dogmatic teaching in my mind, I just thought that I would do what was right, got married. Didn't have any marital counseling, really wasn't in love, I was in lust. Got married, within a couple of months, wife was pregnant, and then all types of hell was going on in my marriage. And I had to come to a place, if we fast forward, that background in that Marine Corps as a criminal investigator, that's what my background is criminal investigator. And they allowed me to be a drug investigator because they said that as I was going through military police school or criminal investigation school, that I tend to pick up on the teaching and how to do the role plays a whole lot quicker than everybody else. Well, that scripture says all things work together for the good for those of us who love the Lord. Well, when I was hanging out in the street when my daddy wasn't looking, I had firsthand knowledge and was taught how to do those things. So when I went to school, it was just natural for me to progress. But the Lord, he got my attention real quick when I found myself in a position of working a covert mission, undercover mission, as a drug dealer. Shot went out. The bullet was meant for me. Drug deal went bad, and it took my partner out. And the reality that I had right there, as I was feeling warmness from his blood on my face, was that your mortality is real. And had that hit you, where would you be at right now? And that was kind of my intro to the reality check of, if there is a God, and it's not a bunch of religion, you need to find out for yourself. And don't allow yourself to mess up your eternity by trying to do things out of spite based off of what you feel. So I'm thankful to God for having the opportunity to actually be here on this morning to better to declare that I'm saved, I love the Lord, and I just have a passion to tell everybody else about Jesus Christ. Is that all right with everybody? Amen. Come on, can we just one more time as I move forward even with this presentation? I just want to give you the background of who I am. Not just some guy that's sitting up here just trying to tell you something that you already know, but I'm a guy that was lost, that was tossed around, and God saved me. Can we one more time collectively? I just believe in praise. Just give God praise one more time. Is that all right?
Yeah. Thank you, Lord.
I want to share with you this morning, today's session. We are image bearers of God, but our sin tarnishes that image. Jesus paid the price for our sin and redeemed us. But we continue to sin in the small and big choices we make daily that are not loving to him or others. And so we ask, why does God want such a broken soul? This session will attempt to answer that question by taking a look at redemption, or rather, for what purposes he has redeemed us. And don't look at sessions at this conference that will help you begin your journey along the path of fulfilling that purpose. Jesus, as I move through this, he paid the price for our sin and he redeemed us. Redemption is that of to be brought back to original state. As we're looking throughout our lives and we look at what has taken place in our lives, look at what has happened through various time frames of our life. Sometimes we're born in, some people are born in a home where you got mom, dad, and some people are born to where you don't have a mother, don't have a father, born in situations. We deal with men on a daily basis. They're all at the church that are coming up from various tough situations where family, their father was the streets. Fathers was the drug dealers, the people who were out there who told them this is the way to go. I have a brother who was just sworn in as a district attorney in Wyandotte County, Kansas City. Another brother who is a judge there in Kansas City. And I'm finding out even throughout that 20 years that I was in the Marine Corps, having sat and spoke with many men in very prestigious places, I'm finding out one thing, that men who avoid a relationship with the Lord, no matter how high society may say that you are, via in the form of what they determine is successful, and no matter how low society may say that you are, as they determine is you're a failure, I'm finding out that no matter what spectrum you're on, and throughout the 20-year tour of the Marine Corps, and throughout these past 43 years of my life, because that's how old I am, I'm finding out that void of a relationship with the Lord, it don't matter what society say, it only matter what God say. And I'm seeing people, and having been that criminal investigator, and having dealt with situations to where I have to have gone in and have to do suicide investigations and homicide investigations, found out that there are people who had absolutely nothing that was taking their life, and there's people that have had more money than they know what to do with that have taken their life. And the reality behind that is, void of a personal relationship with the Lord. I don't care how much you get or how much you don't have. True fulfillment only comes from Him. It only comes from Him. So when you look at this redemption to be brought back to original state, text says very clearly up there, before I formed you, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you. I ordained you a prophet to the nations. If we look at that, just very clearly of it, before I formed you, I knew you. The reality is that you're never going to be the man that you were created to be until you put your hands, or rather your heart, into the God that created you. There's a lot of stuff that the world would determine is successful. But the question you got to ask yourself is, where am I at? Where am I at right now? What has defined my success? Is it my career? Is it my marriage? What has defined me to be successful? And this whole understanding of the No Regrets Conference and what we're trying to do, God's allowed for us to come together to be able to explore who we are because of whose we are, not because of what we become based off of our career choices. 20-year Marine, decorated, up for a Purple Heart for injuries that was declared to have, that had happened in combat. Three of them to be exact. Can be able to take from a football field distance and put a bullet in the center mass of a man. Able to do all this stuff, this big bad Marine that man said was successful. But I went home, I couldn't even have a conversation with my wife. Successful in the eyes of men, but failure in the eyes of the family. We had to do some research and try to figure out what is this that's going on. Well, the purpose of redemption is to get you back to your original state. And if God knew you before He formed you in your mother's womb, and the Word lets us know that He knows the plans that He has for us, no matter what success we may have acquired here, are you successful in a personal relationship with the Lord? Do you know Him for yourself? Yeah, your daddy's a preacher. That's how the Lord talked to me. Anybody else have the Lord that have to be very direct and clear when He talks to you? He talks to me very clearly and direct. So what? I don't care how many decorations you have on your chest. I don't care how high up the food chain and what's considered the toughest branch of the Marine Corps. I know I probably got some others who would disagree with me. That's all right. No matter how far up you may be on this food chain, how far up you on my chain, I've redeemed you. Not for you to run through life acquire success based off of what people say, but what does my word say? Yes, you can put a bullet center mass in a man's chest, but can you pray a code off of your 2-year-old daughter? Yes, you can wrestle and fight amongst the best, but can you sit down and have a conversation with your son who's struggling with teenage puberty issues? What you gonna do? How bad are you? That was a reality check for me. And redemption, God redeemed us, not for us to be able to accomplish what we want to accomplish, but to be able to accomplish what he sent us here to accomplish. And through life, we find ourselves getting caught up, making choices that we feel are most beneficial to us as the man, without understanding that we're more than the man. We're God-man. God knew us before he formed us in our mother's womb, and he's redeemed us to be able to accomplish the purpose that he sent us here to accomplish. And I just want to pause right there for 1 second, because I don't want to sit here and just speech or preach, but I want to dialogue with you. Sometimes life will throw things at you and you feel like, hey, I got it all together and I'm doing good. And we get caught up in doing good. Or on the opposite end, when I don't feel like I can go on because I'm a failure. I don't have enough money to take care of myself, let alone my family. I've been caught up. The question I have that I want to throw out even right now is, what do you think? And I want some engagement. Please engage me and talk with me. Why do you think society bases success on your career, your status, vices, what we know is true success? Can anybody tell me, why do you think society tells you or implies that you're successful based off of what you do? I got a young man all the way in the back. Go ahead real quick, and I got my man up here. Stand up and talk loud so we can hear you. That's good. Go ahead, sir.
They think I'm successful because I have a nice car.
You hear that? Nice car? What kind of car you got?
It's a Dodge Avenger 14.
Is that a nice car, son? My son's a car open right there.
I think it's nice.
Yeah, he loves cars. I think it's nice too. Go ahead, sir.
I think it's a generational thing. I think a lot of us are taught this way by our parents, and their parents taught by their parents. It's a generational thing, in my opinion. It's just what we're taught. It's somebody got to break the cycle. That's why we're here. It's not about what we do for a job.
Definitely not about what you do for a job. Come on, talk back to me. Go ahead, sir. I'm loving this. Who else? Right here in the back, then right here. Curry, come up here. What you gonna do is you gonna take this mic. Can y'all hear me without this mic?
Go ahead. I grew up with the thought process that the difference between men and boys is the price of their toys. So it was always the bigger gun, the better car, the better whatever. And of course, it was always the fact that you had to climb that ladder and achieve the best you could.
Love it. Go ahead. It's right up here. I had another one. Run right on here.
I'm going to say society is looking at what's seen and what's on the outside. That's what we all, that's the easiest thing to base things off of. So it's really the what's seen part of it that's there. And God says it should be what's the, we should look for the unseen.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, also too, it's about mass control. It's about mass control of having people think a certain way that really, doesn't line up with God. Also too, it just doesn't line up with just you know, how we really should treat each other. You know, it's about, you know, it's just like a popularity contest too. It's not always about stuff, but it's also about a way of thinking. You know, that people want people to think certain ways. Like in high school, like me in high school, and, you know, popularity contest, and you know, our people, you know, if you don't get this type of clothes or that type of clothes, and you know, so it's just a lot of things that go on, and it is generational. A lot of stuff is just repetitive, like I said in the Bible, nothing's new under the sun. You know, I've been judged a lot of my life, still get judged, but I just try to stay grounded, not only in God, but just to try to stay grounded in my individuality as a human being. You know, I don't always just flow with everything just because this is where everybody's flowing with. You know, and the more I keep going closer with God, the more that the little blessings that I do know that He wants me to do, are the tasks that He wants me to do, I get closer and closer to making those happen. For His glory, though, you know.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Anybody else? See, here's what's happening, and I'm thankful for the input, and that's why I want us to be engaged here. You hear so much, just hold the mic. You hear so much, you got the seat right there, son. Can we just give God a hand of praise for our volunteers, these young men over here? And see, to me, it was important. I wanted to bring all my sons out. I got one natural son that's biological. These young men are young men that belong to the church that came out with us, and I think it's important for us as grown men to be an inspiration to the young men. So one more time, can we just give God praise for these young men? If you heard everything we said, because society throws a whole lot at you, we're talking about redemption, or rather the purpose of which we were redeemed. You want to get your mind focused as we prepare to move throughout this conference and the various over 30 plus sessions that we had. And you gotta be asking the Lord, Lord, where do you want me to go? Where are you guiding me at? Where am I at this morning? For what purpose have you predestined for me to be here? But the highlights of everything that was said, society will pull you in. And if we're not careful, even though you're a man of God and you're really trying to go in the right direction, because we wouldn't be here at some Saturday, 7 o'clock in the morning, when we can be laying back, you know, on our little sofas or whatever, relaxing. We wouldn't be here if we didn't understand the purpose of which we really need something more than what society is throwing at us. And if we are to be redeemed and understand the purpose of redemption, it's very important for us to understand that the enemy, and we all know who the enemy is. Who's our enemy? Satan. The devil's our enemy. He would love to pull us in to keep us off course of which we were deemed. We understand that I am a spirit. For before God, before I was even formed in my mother's womb, God knew me. And I've been redeemed. I'm spirit, I have a soul, I just happen to live in this body. And my body just happened to be a little darker than most everybody else's right in this room. And when I teach the people at my church, there's only one race that God created in His image, and that's the human race. In spite of what you look like on the outside, my question is, who do you have on the inside? And we can't let our skin color, our social class, these barriers, our Democratic, Republican, nonpartisan parties, we can't let this stuff block us, because here's what society will do. He'll even creep up into the body of Christ, men who are looking to be men of God, and cause us to be divided because of what society has put up there as barriers. That's why you can look at the history and the statistics, and you can look at Sunday morning, the most segregated place in America. Churches. And I think it has a lot to do with unfortunate barriers that throughout our life we grew up in, that we just tend to migrate to what we know. Talk about the Marine Corps, 20 years. That was a breed of the branch that I really enjoyed. And growing up, I grew up in a predominantly black neighborhood. What did He redeem us for? We're still talking about redemption. My neighborhood was predominantly black. The only interaction that I had with white people was when the police came in and harassed us. That's what I grew up around. I have a vivid image of being about my son's age, 13 or 14. I have a very vivid image of a white police officer getting out, and my mother's driving, getting out, snatching my mother out the car. She didn't have a driver's license. Snatched her out and called her a nigger and smacked her right across the face. In me, I had so much hate that although my daddy was preaching, Son, everybody's not like that. Would you tell that to a 13, 14-year-old boy who's seen it all his life? I wasn't trying to hear this Jesus stuff. Why would Jesus allow this to take place? Well, listen, society, this life, this world that we're in, has its ways to try to pull you outside of the will of God. So we need to understand redemption. I was redeemed not to be a black man, not to be a white man, not to be a Mexican, but to be a man of God. And my ethnicity, this skin color I have, it shouldn't block me from going where God is trying to take me. But inadvertently, even hearing all these things that we're seeing in this room, if you're not careful, it can suck you in. Boot camp. Met a guy in boot camp. His name is Drill Instructor. Hated him with passion. All three of them. One was white. One was Mexican and the other one was black. And I hated all three of them the same. I'm looking at the black guy like, ain't you going to give a brother some mercy? He's like, you're all puke, you're all garbage, you're all nothing. Rap mate. He hated him too. White boy. Didn't know anything about him until we began to go through the hell and boot camp. And as we went through hell and boot camp, we formed a bond. We got close. Got close to the point where we started talking about our backgrounds. His father was hierarchy in the Ku Klux Klan. He grew up being taught that all black people and any non-white are garbage. But we found out that when we were in hell together, that our differences were laid aside. And we formed a bond through our boot camp and throughout the 20-year career in the Marine Corps, went to combat together, saved each other's life. And to this day, his father denounced the Ku Klux Klan just due to the fact that it was a black man that saved his son's life. And likewise, he saved my life on one occasion as well. See, when you are in hell and you're dealing with tough situations, you're able to put aside your differences. Here's what I give to you even on this morning. When you understand that together, especially in this walk with the Lord, in spite of where you come from, in spite of the issues, the devil, our enemy, wants to take a white man out, a black man out, anybody who's calling on the name of Jesus Christ, he wants to take you out. So we need to make sure that as we've been redeemed, we stay focused on why we've been redeemed and not get sucked into this society's definition of what success is. Can we pause even right there and just give God praise because we're moving in the right direction? Look at this, he said, no matter what sin we did, he bought us back. We're not fighting from victory. Or rather, we're not fighting for victory, we're fighting from victory. Jesus gave us the victory way back on Calvary's cross. And this is what we got to understand as men of God. Way back on Calvary's cross when Jesus died, he died for us when we were yet sinners. He didn't wait for us to get it right. But he didn't die for us to stay in sin, but rather to draw closer to him. And it's not a checklist of stuff that you can't do. But rather, the closer you get to God, the more you find out those things that you used to do that you're no longer doing it. I used to have a wife and about 10, 15 girlfriends. And when the Lord saved me, as I grew my relationship with the Lord, I found out that it's not that my wife that I'm cheating on, but I'm violating this relationship that I have with the Lord. So I couldn't have to be concerned so much about how does my wife feel, how this is impacting my marriage, but how is this impacting my relationship with God? And the more I saw what he did for me on Calvary's cross, the reason he redeemed me, wasn't so I can fulfill the lust of the flesh or the society's definition of success, but it's so I can fulfill the purpose of which he sent me. And whether that was in the Marine Corps, whether that was in corporate America, whether that whatever you're doing, you got to recognize those things that my daddy used to teach me, son, everything that you do it to the Lord. Whatever you do, I don't care if you're cleaning the toilets at McDonald's or you're sitting in the office as a district attorney like my baby brother. Whatever you do it unto the Lord. And you let him get glory out of your life. That's the purpose of which we were created. That's the essence of who we are because of whose we are. And it's so critical not to get caught up. Can we one more time give God praise? I like praise. I'm in praise. Redemption. I already defined it. Been through it. Go to the next slide. Why does God want such a broken soul? Went through this already. Kingdom assignment. We talked about it. This American dream. We're taught to look out for us. We're taught to fill our days and keep busy. We're taught to get what we can, not about what we can give. Reign, sacrament status. I already covered that. Leviticus 11:41. Then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. God gave us dominion over every creeping thing, not for us to go and get our creep on. And do I got any man who know what that means? See, the enemy, he confuses us. Here we're supposed to have dominion over every creeping thing, but we become the very thing that we're supposed to have dominion over. And unfortunately, and as you look throughout these sessions, this thing is not just in the world to where all them, those sinners are. But if we're not careful, the enemy will have us thinking that we're living a life that's pleasing unto the Lord, but we're still getting our creep on because we become a creeper instead of the man that God wants us to be. The Bible tells us to lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily besets us. And throughout this sessions that we have here, in order to get closer to God, in order to get to that place to where we are able to accomplish what God wants us, we got to be able to evaluate. As the man of God said back there, that's what we're here for. We're here to be able to evaluate, where am I at? What's going on within me? What's not allowing me to accomplish the fullness? The one thing that I know that we as men are, bottom liners, is that we want to get something accomplished. Okay, what am I here for? It's Saturday morning. You got me up. Bottom line, what am I here for? What? You done woke me up. They done put this no regrets. You better have something to give to me. So I'm glad they got the coffee and the cookies and stuff. What am I here for? You got to ask yourself that. What am I? What am I here for? And the only way you can figure that out is by asking him. God knew us before he formed us in our mother's womb. And we're created in his image after his likeness. I really kind of just touch on this very, very briefly in that if you understand that when God created us, he created Adam, created the first man, the Bible says he breathed the breath of life into him. And then that man became a living soul. So you look at the Play-Doh, you look at the skin, so to speak, the Play-Doh, you look at our frame, and then you look at when did we become a living soul. It wasn't until he breathed the breath of life inside of us. And then here we are, we're born into this world. We're in this world. And as Adam did way back in the Garden of Eden, that first thing that he had was what? A connection with God. He had that connection, that breath of life, made him alive, made him who he was. That breath of life makes us who we are. And what this world does, it tends to, especially due to the fact of this thing called sin, it breaks us from that connection that we have with that breath of life that God gave us. But then we start walking around acquiring stuff. We're still able to accomplish things. We're still able to get things done. We become successful. But that first and foremost thing that really made us who we are was that connection that we had with God. And when that connection is gone, even though you may acquire man's definition of success, you're still void of your purpose. You're still void of it. The Bible says, if we seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. What is righteousness? To be in right standing with God. It's nothing deep. To be in right standing with God. Then all these other things shall be added. As men, we have a tendency, even when we're trying to do things in this standpoint of trying to be right before God, there's a tendency that society would try to pull us off to go after all these other things versus going after the first thing, which is stay connected with Him. And this conference is designed to help us stay focused. Because even in church, have you ever, can I talk for a few minutes and once I talk back, have you ever been in church and seen some of our brothers in Christ have moral failures? I can raise my hand right now. Have you ever been in church and seen yourself? And I'm very transparent. Making it so far and getting defined as successful, even in what religious organization would say. And you're so busy doing church stuff that you forget your first minister, your family. That's why God birthed the name of the church that He appointed me to found. Because I recognize that, because it's not about me, it's about Him. The name of the church is Family First Ministry. Because it's me and our first ministries, it's to our homes. What does it profit a man, the Bible says, to gain his whole world and lose his soul? I like that scripture because it gives me understanding. The Lord just kind of gave me a twist to it. What does it profit me as a man of God, preacher, pastor, I don't care what your status is, to be able to witness and save the whole world, but you lose your own family sitting right there living with them? So the Lord gave me that reality check because I grew up. I grew up in that church. My daddy used to say, you better fake it till you make it. But what I found out, as long as you fake it, you ain't never gonna make it. And the sad thing is, we can learn how to fake real good. And people die in the pews. Because they're still clapping their hands, they're still smiling, they're still standing up reading the Bible, and they're still going through the functions of what religious organizations and what church says, but still fell. And this conference is designed that, yes, we're looking, and for the most part, I believe that everyone's coming because they have a desire to get closer to God. So throughout this conference, you need to ask the Lord, Lord, show me. Which one of these sessions do you want me to be at so that I can grow, so I can stay connected to the main thing, and that's you, God. I don't want to be going to church going through the motions. I remember driving to church with my mom and daddy, sitting in the back seat. And they'll be barking at each other all the way to the church. As soon as they pull in the parking lot, and the deacons are there at the parking lot, the fake smiles that come on, hey, how you doing? And I'm sitting there like, the Holy Ghost must be powerful. As soon as they put in the parking lot of the church, the Holy Ghost must have just given them a whole new personality. And then I start doing it with my wife. I start going to church and arguing in the house, fighting all the way to the church and pulling the parking lot. And the enemy make you think, well, you must got the Holy Ghost too. Because as soon as you pull it in, you're smiling. No, God don't want us to have to fake it. He wants us to be true and be transparent and be real, because He knows everything anyhow. You can't fool God. So throughout this conference today, you need to just listen, Lord, where am I at? Am I having some moral issues? Am I having some concerns? Am I still got thoughts? Is my bed defiled? So what's a defiled bed? When you're married, the Bible says the bed's undefiled. You got yourself, okay, am I thinking about my spouse, my wife as defined by the Bible? One man, born a man, ain't it the same? We got to define it like that nowadays. One man, born a man. One woman, born a woman. See, these are things that we don't like to, you know, is it politically correct? Listen, I'm more concerned about being biblically correct than politically correct. Amen. Can everybody just say amen about
amen.
That?
Amen.
So these are issues. These are issues. I'm running for the Appleton Area School District Board. Why? Because I don't want them force feeding my children or any of the child that I believe should have a right to know what the true biblical definition of marriage is. I don't want them forcing it in the school system because they're doing it right now. Everybody say redemption. Say redemption.
Redemption.
I don't care what man tries to redefine. God has set this thing up. And I don't care. Me and my brothers have these conversations all the time. Like I said, one's a district attorney, other one's a judge down there in Wyandotte County. And they have to deal with these conversations. And I believe that as men of God, wherever God orders us to, that we need to view everything from the lens of being Christ-like.
Amen.
We got to view it. I'm not here to try to force wherever I go, whether it's in the Marine Corps, whether it's in Walmart, wherever, if it's on the board, a committee involved in the community. Listen, I'm not trying to force Jesus on anybody. To me, he's too good for that. But I'm not going to let anybody force their views on me. And while everyone else is coming out of the closet, I refuse for Christians to go walk in the closet. I believe that this country was founded on some solid constitution, was derived out of biblical-based principles. I believe our fathers, our forefathers, they founded it. And any organization, if you start tearing up the foundation, this is a beautiful building, beautiful edifices. If you go down to the foundation, you start tearing up, eventually it's going to fall. You study the Roman Empire, you study Russia, you look at the moral fibers of those countries, it was the moral fibers of those countries that began to fail before they became third world countries. We have to stay committed to being one nation under God.
Amen.
We have to stay committed to being in God we trust. We have to stay committed to being able to openly declare, and although we invite everyone's opinion in, just like in the Marine Corps, we would never bow our flag to another country's flag. Then I don't believe we should bow our God to another country's God.
Amen.
Come on, if you're in agreement with that, can you just give God praise right there? To wrap this up, we're here iron sharpening the iron. This is what we're doing. Bible says, prevent not the assembly of the saints. We're here as men of God. We're assembled together so that we can sharpen each other. I need you. You need me. Our young men need us. We need each other. And this is a beautiful Saturday. But to come in amongst all these men, to be able to say, yes, I've dealt with this. The Bible says we're overcomers by the blood of the Lamb and the words of our testimony. And the words of our testimony and the blood of the Lamb. I'm able to tell my son, listen, son, you don't want to make the same mistakes. You don't want to do the same thing. Dad was rebellious. I don't want you to be mad at daddy and think that you're getting back at me because you're going to run out here and make the choices of the contrary. Your true daddy, I still remember my daddy telling me this. Your true father is your heavenly father. He knew you before I even knew your mother. Daddy told me before, he said, listen, son, if you're ever mad at me and you don't agree with what I say, go talk to my daddy about it. The first time he told me that, I remember it's like, grandpa's dead. I ain't never met him. It's like, no, boy, listen. And he began to break it down. If God knew us before he formed us in the mother's womb, I don't care if your natural father wasn't around. I don't care if he was around. Your true daddy. That's why you ask yourself, who's your daddy? Your true father is your heavenly father. And he's always been there. Just give God praise because he's always been there. Amen. I compel you, I encourage you. These are some of the courses that are available. And you ask yourself as you're moving throughout this conference, is it an area of post-truth? There's only truth. Learning. Unanswered prayers. Explore a deep relationship with God. Practical evangelism. Reaching Muslims. Then my brothers, you got some men of God over there and women of God as well that's coming for them. We want to be able to reach everyone. Better reach them all. This conference covers that. Discipleship at home. Discipleship in manhood. Street cred. That's one that I'll be teaching. Street credentials. How to get outside the four walls of your church. Get out there to the highways and byways. That's what Jesus did. Those disciples that we read about today. Peter, he was a well-known gangster. Why do you think he was trying to chop the man's head off, although he missed and got to eat? You got the fishermen. They were known as drunks and alcoholics. You had these tax collectors. Jesus met them where they were, built a relationship with them, and now they're the disciples that we study today. So that's the street cred. It's kind of an abbreviation of street credentials. And I encourage you to, if you're in that area and you want to know how to reach people, I ain't talking about just in the formality of just going out in a church group, but you yourself, everywhere you go. You may not be clergy, but everybody's a preacher. You're supposed to tell somebody about the goodness of Jesus. So how do you do that? How do you kind of open up that door to be able to talk about it? That's a street cred. Intentional disciple making. You got to be intentional. It's not good enough to get saved, but you got to be intentional on teaching them how to stay saved. Celebrate recovery. A lot of men of God are still dealing with issues. See, everybody can get saved, but after getting saved, there's still some steps called deliverance that needs to take place. Sanctification. First, there's salvation. Sanctification. Sanctification is being set apart. Now I need to get my mind transformed. Be not conformed to this world, but you transformed by the renewing of your mind. So you may be saved, but there's some issues that you're wrestling with. But celebrate recovery helps cover some of those strongholds, is what I call them in the spiritual realm, that the enemy put on our life that we're still wrestling with. Coming to church, but I'm still struggling in this area. Celebrate recovery. Your journey, the invisible war. Marriage development. Happy wife, good life. Amen. Sex. Learn what the Bible says about it. I talk to my sons. We got three daughters. I tell them all. And all three of them are black, like my wife and I. But the number one prerequisite, I tell them, listen, daughters, I don't care who you bring home. There's only one prereq. Do they know the Lord? And here in Wisconsin, I've been challenged with that because a couple of my daughters, they said, Daddy, blonde hair, blue eyes look good to me. And I'm sitting like, wow, Lord, this is really happening. Well, does those blonde hair, blue eyes, do they look good to the Lord? Do they know him? If they don't know him, if they're not affiliated with the church, if they're not raised right, then don't bring them home. I don't care if they're black, they're white, Mexican, or yellow. Do they know the Lord? And I'm okay with that. So we're going through that. Can we just give God praise because it don't matter what you look like? Amen. Freedom Fighters, explore a framework of overcoming sexual sin. Live streams are going to be coming in. There's Parenting with No Regrets, How to Have a Strong Marriage, Lead Like Jesus, Integrity Over the Long Haul. I end with this, men of God, whatever you're going throughout this day, I actually ask the Lord to lead and guide you, to show you where do I need to be. And then when you leave here, you don't want to just, I call spiritually obese. You don't want to get just spiritually obese and get all this information and you become a spiritual obese man. And then you walk out and you don't give it to nobody else. So you want to ask the Lord for, Lord, where do I need to go for impartation so that when I get home, I can have implementation to my real life. We want you to be able to get what you're getting. Get all of it. And then go home and apply it. Give it to somebody else. Share the information. Street Cred, we got various books available for outreach. And I encourage you to stop by the table, have a DVD and a how-to pamphlet. DVD and the pamphlet together, $20 donation. It's going to help the ministry continue to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, counsel other men. We primarily reach a lot of the people from the shelters and from the various homeless connections and right there in the downtown area of the streets. We're bringing them in, 150, 200 every Wednesday and Friday that we provide the breakfast for. But they're not just getting provided the breakfast. We have other men of God, women of God, sitting down with them, telling their story, letting them know that, look, I've been there. And here in the past, we're going on year number 5. We watch men go from homelessness to having careers because they had hope, because they received Jesus Christ and God has raised them up, because we want to get them out of that cycle of sin. And once you remove the root cause of all issues of sin, then they're able to progress to be who God wants them to be. So this is really the heartbeat of what God's given us to do as a pastor in downtown. When he ordered my steps here, after coming back from Afghanistan in 2010, he sent me here, gave me orders to Green Bay. I bought my house in Appleton. God showed me, started the church in 2012, and we've been able to reach people and watch lives being transformed. And I'm asking that if you want to be able to know how to get out there in a real practical way, it's simple stuff. And not just, like I said, in a big group orientation type, do it in the church, although that's focused there, but these principles apply to you every day. I don't have to be with a group of men outreaching. Who am I reaching the 2,000 plus people I pass on a daily basis? It gives you a way to connect with them. And we have those resources downstairs. You want to get them quick, because I only brought 100 of them with me. Amen? Whatever you hear about, whatever y'all close, I'm going to close out in prayer. Father God, I thank you for every man here. Lord, you know who we are, you know where we are. You know what's going on in our life. You know what we're dealing with. Lord, you know what issues we have. Lord, I ask you to order our steps to whatever classes you have for us. Show us where you need for us to go, so we can continue to develop and grow and mature in this walk with you to accomplish your purpose. We don't want to be babes for a long time, but there should be some progress and maturity that takes place. And we thank you for a location of no regrets. We thank you for the men of God who's put this forum together. We thank you for senior pastor of this location, Bill Lenz, who's allowed us to be together. Bless us, God. Bless us to accomplish your purpose. This is my prayer. In the name that's above every name, it's in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Thank God. And the church say amen.
Amen.
I thank God for you. I know he said that at the end, we asked questions in between. Is there anything I'm missing? Anybody got anything that they want from me before we leave up out of here? Any questions? Yes, sir.
I have a son-in-law that also with a Marine background. I don't want to take a lot of time.
Yes, sir. Give me 1 second. I would ask, as you're leaving out, please fill out that survey on the back of this program. Fill it out and just say I did an outstanding job all the way around. Go ahead, sir.
I just want to know what, after you got out of service and you had a hard time orienting back in civilian life, what gave you the help that you needed to do this?
Straightforward. The question was, is he wants to know when I got back to the civilian life, what gave me the help that I needed. The bottom line is connecting with another man who's been there. Because you have all these various places that military goes to. I encourage you to have a connect with another military member who can actually talk to him. I'm also a chaplain at the Veterans Court, and there's a corps of men that have been in the military, specifically those who've been in combat. If he's been in combat, that's a whole nother level of issues. But you need other men of God who's been there that he can really be mentored by and be guided by. That's what helped me. It was nothing. I tell everybody, nothing but Jesus who got me where I'm at today. Does that answer your question, sir? So I encourage, we can exchange numbers. I don't mind talking to him and connecting, and even connecting with someone else that he's more comfortable with. So we can definitely do that.
That's your problem. You don't want to talk to
him. And most of them don't. Yeah. You don't want to talk to anybody who don't understand. Most of us, you can't tell me something when you don't know nothing about what I'm dealing with. And it's hard. A lot of men, how can I come up here if you're a mechanic, tell you about how to put an engine in, and I don't even know how to change a flat tire? So in combat, it's a whole different mentality. It's hard for us to open up. My dad didn't even let me know that he was a prisoner of war until after I lost my first friend. He saw some of the signs I was going through. I was getting depressed. I didn't know. I knew he was in the military. I didn't even know that he was. I heard him say something about combat tours, but it didn't register. He was in prison of war for 6 months. I had no idea. Again, he did not open up until he saw his son. He saw a need to open up and begin to tell me some things that he had to do. And that my dad was able to help me come through that. So men, most of us don't open up, especially combat type. It's hard to open up. You need them to connect with somebody else that can share their story. Appreciate you. Anybody else? Well, God bless you. Have a good day. Be guided by the Lord. Let's check out my table. Right downstairs in the middle.
Pretty much take care of it.